advise and analyze the cognitive computing and deep learning startup arena. He has served as CTO for Cadence IP Group, where he and his team developed a new processor and memory for advanced applications in mobile, automotive infrastructure, deep learning, and IoT systems. Chris joined Cadence after its acquisition of Tensilica, the company he founded to develop extensible processors. Before founding Tensilica in 1997, he was VP and general manager of the design reuse group at Synopsys. Chris also was a pioneer in developing RISC architecture and helped it found the MIPS computer systems, where he was VP of microprocessor development. He holds an MSE and PhD in electrical engineering from Stanford and a BA in physics from Harvard. He holds about 50 US and international patents. He was named an IEEE Fellow in 2015 for his work in development of microprocessor technology. The title of his presentation today is Pixels, Deep Learning and Startups, the Revolution in Ubiquitous Imaging. Let's welcome Chris Rowan.
Thank you very much. I'm really in the enviable position of being able to wrap up after a number of really interesting talks that have given us many of the important dimensions of this AI and deep learning phenomenon. But I want to particularly talk about vision. Vision is not only a good example of what's happening with deep learning, but it is in fact one of the most potent drivers of that whole space. And it is having quite profound impact on the economics of electronic systems, on the technology of electronic systems, and on the entrepreneurial climate that we find in electronics. So I think it tells us a number of interesting stories. And in fact, it's useful to start with one fairly simple picture, one little fact. And this fact is that we see this rapid growth in the number of image sensors. And in fact, if you just make the assumption that image sensors last for about 3 years, we can fairly compare the number of human beings on the planet to the number of image sensors. And it's quite important that in the last year or two, we've seen this dramatic crossover where there are now significantly more cameras deployed than there are people deployed on the planet. And it's significant because, first of all, it says that cameras are no longer to create pretty pictures for people to look at. There are too many pretty pictures and not enough people to look at them. So it fundamentally means that most pixels will be consumed by computer vision, not by humans. And that transforms the nature of what we are expecting cameras to do. The second thing it means is that we have an enormous amount of data. In fact, image sensors produce far more data, orders and orders of magnitude more data than microphones or accelerometers or any other sensor you can think of. And so while there is a great variety and a huge number of sensors, in fact, 99% of the data that we're capturing from sensors today is pixels. It is images. And therefore, it really is the driver for what's going to happen in computing, in networks, and in storage. In fact, if you just take these rough numbers that within 2 or 3 years, we expect there to be 20 billion cameras deployed in one form or another. And if you take the raw potential data bandwidth, you're talking about 10 to the 19 raw pixels per second that are potentially being generated. And that's likely to overwhelm any networking infrastructure, any storage media, and any computing capability that we might anticipate. And so we really are going to see this flood of pixels as a fundamental driving force in the shape of electronics, the shape of networks, the shape of device versus cloud. And in fact, we can quantify that a little bit by just taking this one little anecdotal example. A few weeks ago, I went on Amazon to find the cheapest surveillance camera I could, and for $11.99, I could get a high-definition camera in housing and power supply and electronics and infrared illumination for 12 bucks. Now, we know how cost optimization works, and so it's a pretty good bet that within a couple of years, that won't be $12, that will be $5. And the power dissipation will probably have been cut in half. And so now we potentially have a world that can be filled with $5 cameras. We should ask the question, how much does a $5 camera cost? Well, we're going to do something with all those pixels from all of those $5 cameras. So let's do a simple back of the envelope computation about where those costs go, particularly if we start from some very simple starting assumptions. First, we're going to make the assumption that we want to process this huge flood of pixels in the cloud. And second, we're going to make the assumption that we just stream those raw pixels to the cloud. And we can see what that might cost. In fact, we're going to look at different formats. We're going to look at networking costs, storage costs, and compute costs, and add up what is the cost over the three-year life of that camera. First, we might notice that the camera costs $5, but we can estimate that the electricity just to power that camera costs about twice that amount. So our $5 camera is really a $14. But let's move on, because some of the other factors are a little bit significant. First, the network. Now, it makes a big difference whether you're on fiber or you're on more conventional network, if you're on DSL or cable. Because if you are taking those raw pixels, you're going to spend something like $1 million for one camera over the course of 3 years. By the way, I did a little bit of analysis. Supposing we needed to stream all that raw data on a wireless network, on cellular, and I looked at the data rate in my AT&T plan, one camera would cost $5 billion. Now, AT&T likes the idea, but I'm not sure it scales to 20 billion devices. Nevertheless, when you take even the lower cost of fiber, and you look at a couple of different scenarios for the storage of our video, that is, you know, we're holding on to it for a day or a month, and then we assume some fairly sophisticated computing, and here I'm assuming an object detection algorithm called YOLO. And I'm even assuming significant improvements in algorithm efficiency and significant cost reductions in cloud computing. We're still talking about something from $100,000 to $1 million to service my $5 camera. Now, of course, I'm not really going to stream raw pixels. At least I'm going to do standard H.264 compression on this assumed 4K UHD screen. But even so, I'm talking about thousands of dollars to support my $5 camera. Now, in fact, there are some video streams that are worth thousands of dollars over 3 years, but probably not the great number. In fact, you have to start thinking about reducing the frame rate down to one frame per second, or maybe one frame per minute, to get the costs down to a level which are reasonably comparable to the capital costs and the other operating costs for this camera. And that strongly suggests that finding various ways to filter it, to do video compression, to do something at the edge, so that I'm only passing on one frame in 1,000 or less, is an essential part of what it means to have such a visually rich environment. And in fact, we will see many systems which are completely autonomous, certainly in cars and in many kinds of devices where we can't afford in latency or cost or power or bandwidth to use any significant amount of this infrastructure. question, where fundamentally does computing happen? This question is posed very specifically in the context of cameras. But it is a good standing for the whole set of questions that surround IoT, around mobile, and a whole, the whole cross-section of computing models that we see going forward. So, first of all, we expect to see many cameras, and in fact, many cameras that are densely populated in space, so that we will certainly have some amount of in-camera processing. We will also see local area networks with dedicated local area processing that captures the overall effect of a whole group of cameras. And that's important because in some of these surveillance scenarios, for example, there will be many cameras viewing at any given point. And you can get a much more robust understanding of what's going on if, in fact, you can combine those views to tell you what's going on. But we may also want to take those streams or parts of those streams and pass them up through the network access up to this still somewhat hypothetical category of cloud edge server. This is the idea that you can bring the server type environments closer to where the action is. But ultimately, a lot of the data, a lot of the sophistication may want to be in the cloud. That's certainly the place where you expect significant data storage to take place. That's where you might find the richest analytics. That's where you're going to find the longest term storage. But each of these networks, each of these computing layers has its own advantages and disadvantages. At one end of the spectrum, the cloud is extremely flexible. It is very general purpose. You can do lots of different things. The cloud doesn't care what algorithms you want. It can do it. On the other hand, it's very expensive. The meter is running. You pay as you go. The energy cost, the capital cost, the operating costs are all really quite significant. And it's in sharp contrast to what you find at the other end of the spectrum, where we know from our experience with the phenomenal reduction in costs in embedded computing that you can do a quite remarkable computation for pennies when it has been optimized for deeply embedded implementation. So if you look at some of the different trade-offs, some of the different issues, and see how they map onto this question of where does the computing happen. In general, latency is going to be far better for the computing which is very close to the camera, very close to the device. The layers of protocol and the physical distance add up to quite significant latency issues in going all over the cloud. On the other hand, the scope of data analysis, the ability to draw on multiple streams and other types of data will generally be much better if you're working in the cloud. The issues of privacy are real and important, and certainly the less data, the less sensitive data that you need to pass up to the cloud, the more your most private information will be protected. And finally, in general, networking costs and computing costs are all increasing, and increasing potentially by several orders of magnitude as you move. So let's see how this affects what's going on in some specific domain. Let's take the automotive domain. This, the self-driving car, this idea of cars with significant vision capability, is decades old. And people have been working on vision algorithms with applications like automotive in mind for a long time. But in the last 3 or 4 years, these deep learning algorithms have swept the board almost completely, displacing the classical object recognition or tracking algorithms completely. And in fact, here I show in an interesting survey paper, I think 24 different core algorithms for car vision. In green are the cases where the algorithm that wins is a deep neural network algorithm. And red are the ones that still are classical algorithms. In fact, the RFQ still today typically where it's an algorithm in manipulation of a 3D structure or 3D representation, where the classical algorithms still hold on. But that's likely to change in the near future as well. We also care a lot about some fundamental questions of robustness and security and privacy. And certainly one of the things we see is significantly more risks to privacy. Not just because there are more cameras, but there is better and better analysis that can correlate what's happening across multiple camera streams and between camera streams and other kinds of information. So it's likely that cameras will not only be able to tell who you are, but who you're with, what you're talking about, what's your health, and what's your finances. So we have to think as a society very carefully about these implications. We also have new kinds of exposure in the robustness and security of these systems. Not only do we have all the old problems of networked devices, but we have new kinds of problems, like the possibility of manipulation of the database that may subtly inject bias into the behavior of the system in ways that are very hard to detect. And spoofing. Neural networks are surprisingly fragile in many cases, where even small changes to the images, artificial changes to the images, can cause complete disruption of spoofing. As Rob Aiken said, you know, in this this wonderful CMU work, this is Reese Witherspoon. This is Reese Witherspoon wearing glasses. This is what it's recognized as, which is Russell Crowe. One of the really important implications has been an architectural revolution in the design of processors and functions for evaluating or training these neural networks. And in fact, what you see is unique characteristics of the problem in terms of the level of parallelism, the tolerance of low precision, and the opportunity to use moderate bandwidth and specialized architectures to sustain incredible levels of computation. And here, I look at the absolute performance per chip measured in gigamax per chip, billions of multiply ads per second, and here, energy efficiency, gigamax per second per watt. And we have seen the data center GPUs, for example, from NVIDIA, that have moved up into the right significantly. FPGAs have been following a similar trajectory. Google TPU has been written about quite a bit. And all of these are pushing to a performance level which is about an order of magnitude and a half higher in efficiency than what you get out of traditional data center GPUs. We also have seen processor cores that have been moving on a similar trajectory. Here, vision DSPs, and then increasing levels of neural network optimization, such that we now have in the marketplace a variety of different kinds of accelerators and neural network DSPs that are well above a trillion multiply ads per watt, mostly for inference, and really holding promise for enormous amounts of efficiency, both in the data center and in devices, and people working even on some really novel, low-precision analog methods that may bring us another factor of 5 or 10 efficiency. And just to look briefly at what one of these things might look like, there are a whole set of things that are important to these architectures. How many multipliers? What density? What flexibility? What programmability? What memory features? How do you handle the sparsity of the data? How do you do this so it works on small batches? How do you do this without relying on the CPU? And in the case of one design I know fairly well, the Tensilica Vision C5, I know you're a semiconductor bunch, so let's get into some semiconductor guts. It is an approach which is fairly unique to the problem of this very dense computation, where you see an opportunity both to use many cores in parallel with distributed memory across them on a single chip, such that you can reasonably conceive of as much as a couple of hundred of these cores in the chip, but then a novel architecture of the individual core, which is exploiting the inherent density of computation in order to do not just vector processing, but true tensor processing as an integral part. So that a single core of 1 square millimeter in 16 nanometer can be doing a trillion multiplies per second, or 1,000 multiplies per second. So there are some implications in terms of what this means in the innovation space, in the startup space. And one of the things we see is this explosion of new chip designs focused on new architectures for neural networks. I'm tracking 17 of these startups right now, and I'm hearing about a new startup about every 3 weeks in this space. It's an amazing number, considering how tough it has been to do chip startups around the world. But it clearly implies we will have a lot of very high performance, low power silicon, both in cloud and in device, potentially available to system architects and programmers. In fact, it's really useful to look at what's happening in the space overall. And everybody likes to talk about AI. The best working definition of an AI startup is any startup started since 2014. But it is possible to look inside and say, let's find the set that really are knowledgeable about, dedicated to this key deep learning concept, which is the most distilled essence of the innovation which has rocked the world over the last few years. And one of the things I've done is create this list of the top roughly 300 startups worldwide. And I've traveled to China, to Japan, and around the US, and elsewhere to try and identify them and sort them out in various categories. And it gives us a little bit of a clue as to what deep learning startups look like overall. First of all, a lot of them are doing cloud software. Probably two-thirds of the startups are, in fact, focused in cloud deployment of new applications, because there's such a rich set of end opportunities. About half of the total are doing something with vision, either in the cloud or in devices. Embedded is still important, as you know, about a third of them are doing embedded, and as I say, a lot of chip startups within. But we can look at it in a number of different ways. What are the segments that they are going after? There's a lot of deep learning cloud infrastructure. Security and surveillance is very big. Human-machine interface, audio and language, medicine, autonomous vehicles, marketing and advertising, drones and robots make up sort of the top three of those segments. All really important areas of innovation, either in pushing forward the fundamental capabilities of the underlying technology or exploring some of the novel applications that come out of it. We can also look at it geographically. I think that the trends follow what you see in a lot of entrepreneurial activity. And here I focus on the vision set. But the US, Israel, UK, and China really are the happening places, with a long but fairly skinny tail of other countries, Canada, India, Japan, and the rest. And in terms of where the US, this is even more than other startup issues, it's a California phenomenon, to a surprising extent. We can also ask the question, what are people doing as business models, as strategies, as ways of getting in? And basically, we can think of four essential strategies for vision startups. It's doing a better job on the vision streams by applying improved algorithms. Or it's extracting new kinds of information from those existing streams. So suppose you have access to a video surveillance stream. Why can't you be extracting teen fashion trends or micro weather from those trends? Or it's applying new business models that bring new users and new kinds of value extraction on. Or finally, cameras in new places. Putting cameras in chemical plants to detect gas leaks. Putting cameras in agricultural robots. Blue River, just recently acquired by Deere, has a see and spray robot, which puts a little dot of herbicide on the weeds. dramatically reducing the amount of herbicide use in the fields and improving their overall yields. And so we really have reached a very exciting time in the evolution of the vision scene and the larger scene about deep learning and cognitive computing. Certainly cameras will be everywhere. And both the functionality of the systems and the economics drive a need for significant local intelligence. Not everything is going to be in the cloud. You can't. It's too expensive. It's too slow. This means also we're going to see significant new computing models, new kinds of hardware architectures, new kinds of algorithms. And that's helping to drive very heavy startup activities. But we should also be aware of the issues of privacy, security, and robustness that will be painfully learned and must be consciously addressed if this field is going to really move forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you. Wow, $5 camera. I'm in the ASIC business. Last year, we designed an ASIC for a customer who specializes in DLSR quality camera. And guess how much I charge them for the chip? Not the camera, the chip that goes to the camera. More than $5.
But I think what you find is if you think about some of these new accelerator and neural network processors, something like that Vision C5 processor, its marginal cost to add to a platform might be less than 25 cents. So that you can have huge computing power deployed into low-cost ASIC, I think very readily today. And it will change the level of intelligence that you find down at the device is really quite dramatic.
Great. Yeah, and I sure hope my customer is not sitting here listening to you today. But in any case,
your cost and their cost are different.
There we go. We did collect quite a few questions. So I'm just, again, with the, given the time constraint, I'm just going to pose one question here, and I'm sure you will be around after this. So this person wants to know, in addition to the questions you mentioned in the second to the last page slide, can you share with us another challenging computer vision problem that has yet to be addressed that perhaps you can encourage the startups you work with to address?
Yeah, I think if we take the whole progress in computer vision problems, there's been enormous progress made on single frame problems. That is, what's going on in this picture? What's going on? Where are the objects in this picture? Another problem, the real problem we care about, is rarely the single still image, it's the video. And we want to know not just nouns, what is in the picture, but we want to know verbs, what's happening in this sequence. And so there's certainly some amount of research work that's going on in video captioning and the like to tell the story associated with it. But I think that we are literally just seeing the tip of the iceberg so far on a big range of video problems where the intent, the knowledge we want to gain is much more than just the sequence of individual frames. And so I think all of these vision problems associated with looking over different time scales, what's happening in this second of video, or what's happening in this hour of video, or what's happening in this year of video, are going to be really important questions, and a huge number of opportunities are going to emerge for this much deeper and broader understanding of image and video content.
Great. Thanks again, Chris. Before we let Chris go, can we have Richard to present a token of appreciation?